Hello students, welcome to this live session of biology for class 11 students. Today on 14th of April 2020, I am going to share this first live session for class 11 students on chapter 2, biological classification. Welcome all the students, please call your friends to join this live session. We are going to start the live session of chapter 2, biological classification in a short while. You all have studied chapter 1 of biology, in which you had got the concept of biological classification. I think now you all know what is biological classification. Classification is the branch of biology which deals with the grouping of organisms. Why grouping is important? So that we can group similar organisms having similar characteristics and we can study their features, and it can also be referred for future studies. So now you all know why classification is so important for us. So in the last chapter, we studied the concept of biological classification and the need of biological classification. But today we are going to study the various systems of biological classifications which have been put forward so far. So in this chapter, we are going to study about the different systems of classification. The students who have just joined in, it is for your information that this session is for class 11th biology students, and we are going to study chapter 2, biological classification. This is the basic chapter which will give you an insight about the process, about the systems of classification, the various systems which came into existence since the start of human civilization, and how different scientists, they use their caliber, they use their scientific background to classify the organisms on different basis, what all systems we have rejected, the reasons of their rejection, and the basic system and the latest system which we are following, and why did we get in the favor of following that system. So right from the start of the human civilization, we have always tried to classify the organisms for our own convenience. That doesn't mean that we were born scientists, no, but it was only because of our need. The ancient people were only interested in those organisms which were of our need. Need means the basic needs of food, shelter, and clothing. So we were not having any interest in other organisms, but only those organisms which were for our own use, to provide us food, to provide us shelter, and to provide us the clothing. And different scientists, they started giving their opinions to classify the organisms. First of all, Aristotle. I hope you all must have heard about the name, the great Aristotle. He is also called the father of biology. As a matter of fact, he is also called the father of zoology. That is a branch of science that studies animals. So he was the first to classify the organisms. He was not a great scientist to classify the organisms on various aspects. He was just like a person like you and me. He used the basic feature of morphology to classify the organisms. Now, I think you all know what is morphology. You studied in chapter 1. So, I think by mistake, I've written chapter 1 in the title. It is chapter 2. Okay, so here we can see the pick of Aristotle, the father of biology. He is the father of biology because he was a pioneer in giving the classification system, the basic system of classification, in which he used morphological features. So I was discussing what is morphology. The outer appearance or the external characteristics of any organism is called morphology. Means the outer appearance, how the organism is looking, whether that organism is a plant or an animal, the basic feature of those organisms he used to classify them. So he classified the plants and animals on the basis of their external features. So how did he classify the plants? He classified the plants in three basic categories, which you and me can also differentiate. He classified the plants into three groups: herbs, shrubs, and trees. We can easily identify the herbs, shrubs, and trees, and so he did. He classified the plants in three groups: herbs, shrubs, and trees, on the basis of the morphological features, the external appearance of those plants. He also classified the animals. You know, he was a basic scientist. He was a biologist who was also into dissection. So he dissected many specimens and he checked whether those animals, the specimens of those animals, they had blood in them or they didn't have the blood in them. So he classified the animals in two groups: the animals which had blood, which had red blood, and the animals which did not have red blood. So now today we know that these two categories were vertebrates and invertebrates. But he didn't know. He just classified the animals on the basis of a simple feature: the animals which had red blood in them and those animals which did not have blood in them. So now you all know what was a simple classification system given by Aristotle. He classified plants into herbs, shrubs, and trees. And he classified animals into two groups: the animals which had red blood and the animals which did not have red blood. So that was a basic system of classification given by Aristotle. But you know, in a particular field, when there is a pioneer, when you do a job which nobody has done, so then you become very important, significant, and your name becomes immortal. So it means Aristotle, by his basic scientific aptitude, he became the father of biology. So you all should also apply your minds, and you can also do many discoveries and inventions in new fields which have been untouched so far. Okay, so after Aristotle, now we move on to the next system of classification. Now there is a slide which shows the basic work of Aristotle. You can just read this slide. Aristotle is the father of biology. He was the first to classify organisms scientifically on the basis of morphological features. Aristotle classified the animals into two groups: the animals with red blood, which we know are vertebrates, and the animals which did not have red blood. Today we know they are invertebrates. But this classification was not followed then. It was only the animals with red blood and the animals without the red blood. Aristotle also classified plants into these three groups. You can see herbs, shrubs, and trees. तो अब सभी बच्चों को ये पता चल गया होगा कि एरिस्टोटल ने बहुत ही बेसिक सिस्टम ऑफ क्लासिफिकेशन दिया, जिसमें प्लांट्स को उसने क्लासिफाई किया हर्ब्स, श्रब्स और ट्रीज में, एनिमल्स को क्लासिफाई किया दो ग्रुप्स में, वो एनिमल्स जिनमें रेड ब्लड होता है और वो एनिमल्स जिनमें रेड ब्लड नहीं पाया गया. सो आफ्टर दिस बेसिक सिस्टम ऑफ क्लासिफिकेशन वी मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट साइंटिस्ट, अ वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट वन, एंड यू ऑल नो हिम, यू हैव स्टडीड अबाउट हिम in the chapter 1. So in chapter 1 you studied about Carolus Linnaeus. He is also called the father of modern botany. He is also called father of taxonomy. This term taxonomy you have studied in chapter 1. So I think you all know what is taxonomy. For those students who have not attended the session for chapter 1, I must tell you what is taxonomy. It is a branch of biology which deals with three aspects. First is identification of various organisms on the basis of their features. Second aspect is classification. Once you identify the organism, then you need to categorize it, you need to group it according to similar or dissimilar characteristics of organisms. So you classify the organisms in logical groups. And the third aspect is naming. After classifying the organisms, you have to name it, because unless you name, it cannot be referred in future. When on the common platform you want to discuss about an organism, then you need to know its name. As in a class, every student has a particular name which helps us to interact with you. Similarly, the organisms also need to have particular name. So this naming is also very important. It has to be global. It has to be universal, so that worldwide a single organism has got a common name. So taxonomy, it means it deals with three things: identification of organism, classification of organism, and finally naming the organism for the future reference. So it was a tedious task. Carolus Linnaeus did it very efficiently. That is why he's called father of taxonomy. He's also called father of modern botany. You all know that. He proposed two kingdom classification. He classified the organism on the basis of their simple morphology. So he also followed the morphological features. Although he did very great job, but the job was only limited to morphological features, how the organisms appear. He did not go into the detail of further investigation. And you all know he studied plants as well as animals. He studied different organisms, even the microbes. And he gave the data of all that or all those organisms in his famous book. The book which you already know, in the session one of chapter one, you have been taught about that book, Systema Naturae. So in Systema Naturae, the book written by the great Carolus Linnaeus, he explained or he gave the detail of all the plants and animals he discovered. You can see in this diagram, which has been given here on the slide, this is a simple diagram of two kingdom classification given by Carolus Linnaeus. You can see this leaf shows the organisms included under plants, and this leaf shows the organisms which were grouped under animals. See, right from algae, bacteria, fungi, bryophytes, spermatophyta, that is gymnosperms and angiosperms, and of course pteridophyta also, he included all these organisms under plants. See how diverse these all groups are, but on the basis of their common morphology, their similar morphology, he somehow grouped all these groups under the kingdom, common group, plant, kingdom Plantae. And then he observed all the other groups like Porifera, Coelentrata, Platyhelminths, then Nematihelminths, Mollusca, Annelida, Arthropoda, and Echinodermata. He grouped all these organisms under animals. Today we know how diverse these organisms are, these groups are. But on the basis of their morphological features, Carolus Linnaeus, he grouped all of them under animals. So can you see how simple was that classification? He just had one line of thought, the morphology, the basic outer characteristics, the external characteristics of organisms. And on the basis of the external characteristics, कैसे ऑर्गेनिज्म दिखते हैं, सिर्फ कैसे दिखते हैं कि बेस पर ही उसने सारे ऑर्गेनिज्म्स को या तो प्लांट्स में डाल दिया या फिर एनिमल्स में डाल दिया। ये सिस्टम भी आज हमें बड़ा अजीब लगता है, लेकिन उस समय जब क्लासिफिकेशन का कोई सिस्टम नहीं था, उस टाइम पर जब कैरोलस लिनियस ने ये सिस्टम दिया, तो इसको बहुत अप्रिशिएट किया गया और बहुत समय तक इसको फॉलो भी किया गया, जब तक फर्दर इन्वेस्टिगेशंस नहीं हुई। कैसी फर्दर इन्वेस्टिगेशन? मॉर्फोलॉजी से आगे जाके जब तक इन्वेस्टिगेशन नहीं हुई, जैसे ऑर्गेनिजम्स की जब तक एनाटॉमी चेक नहीं हुई, जब तक उनके सेल वॉल के बारे में पता नहीं चला, जब तक उनके एंसेस्ट्री के बारे में, एवोल्यूशन के बारे में नहीं खोजा गया, तब तक ऑर्गेनिजम्स को सिर्फ दो ग्रुप्स में ही डाला गया, प्लांट्स और एनिमल्स। सो दिस इज कॉल्ड द टू किंगडम क्लासिफिकेशन प्रपोज्ड बाय द ग्रेट कैरोलस लिनियस। सो हियर आर द हाइलाइट्स, यू कैन सी all the organisms, they are divided into two groups according to Carolus Linnaeus, either the plants or the animals. So he based the classification on the basis of the morphology of organisms and the locomotion. Locomotion means the mobility. The organisms can move or not. We all know that some organisms, they have limited mobility or they cannot move at all. Those all organisms were grouped under plants. Un sabhi ko plants keh diya gaya, jo bahut limited movement karte the ya karte hi nahi the. Aur jo organisms movement kar sakte the, un sabhi ko animals mein dal diya gaya. Morphology ke base pe उन्होंने प्लांट्स और एनिमल्स को डिफरेंशिएट किया. लेकिन आपको पता है आज कितने ऐसे ग्रुप्स हैं जो कि इन दो बेसिस पर क्लासिफाई नहीं किए जा सकते. तो बेसिकली ये जो लिनियस की टू किंगडम क्लासिफिकेशन थी, इसमें भी बहुत सारे फ्लॉज थे, बहुत सारी गलतियां थी. लेकिन उस समय पर ऐसी क्लासिफिकेशन थी किसी ने नहीं दी थी, इसीलिए इसे भी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट माना गया. क्रिटिसिज्म क्या है इसका, क्यों इसे डिसकंटिन्यू कर दिया गया, क्यों फॉलो नहीं किया गया? तो इसका क्रिटिसिज्म ये है कि इसने लिनियस ने सारे प्रोकैरियोट्स और यूकैरियोट्स को एक ही ग्रुप में डाल दिया. इन द सेंस उसने ग्रुपिंग करते हुए ये नहीं सोचा कि कौन सा ऑर्गेनिज्म प्रोकैरियोटिक है, कौन सा यूकैरियोटिक है. लिनियस ने ये नहीं सोचा कौन सा ऑर्गेनिज्म यूनिसेलुलर है, कौन सा मल्टीसेलुलर है. ना ही उसने इस बात पर डिफ्रेंशिएट किया कि कौन सा ऑर्गेनिज्म फोटोसिंथेसिस कर सकता है और कौन सा ऑर्गेनिज्म फोटोसिंथेसिस नहीं कर सकता है. एक बार हम जरा उसके ये टर्म्स को जान लें, ये टर्म्स क्या, इनका मतलब क्या है. आई नो यू ऑल नो अबाउट दीज टर्म्स, यू हैव स्टडीड दीज टर्म्स सिंस 9th स्टैंडर्ड, बट जस्ट फॉर अ रिकैपिटुलेशन, जस्ट फॉर अ रिवीजन, वी विल क्विकली अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट दीज टर्म्स इंडिकेट. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल प्रोकैरियोट्स, व्हाट आर प्रोकैरियोट्स? द सेल्स व्हिच डू नॉट हैव मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड ऑर्गेनेल्स. वो ऑर्गेनिज्म, वो सेल्स जिनके अंदर मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड ऑर्गेनेल्स नहीं होते, जिनमें न्यूक्लियर मेम्ब्रेन नहीं है. न्यूक्लियर मेम्ब्रेन ना होने की वजह से उनमें वेल डिफाइंड न्यूक्लियस भी नहीं होता है. जितने भी मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड ऑर्गेनेल्स हैं, जैसे एंडोप्लाज्मिक रेटिकुलम, गॉल्गी बॉडी, ये सब उनके अंदर नहीं होते. सच सेल्स आर कॉल्ड प्रोकैरियोटिक सेल्स एंड सच ऑर्गेनिजम्स आर कॉल्ड प्रोकैरियोट्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल बैक्टीरिया, ब्लू ग्रीन एल्गी, दे कम अंडर प्रोकैरियोट्स. And then eukaryotes. What are eukaryotes? The cells which have membrane-bound organelles are called eukaryotic cells. You all know that. So, वो organisms जिनमें ऐसे cells पाए जाते हैं, जिनमें membrane-bound organelles होते हैं, nuclear membrane present है, इसकी वजह से well-defined nucleus होता है उनके अंदर, nuclear content बाकी के cytoplasm से differentiated है. न्यूक्लियस के अंदर जो डीएनए आरएनए है वो आसपास के साइटोप्लाज्म से डिफरेंशिएटेड है, उसको डिफरेंशिएट न्यूक्लियर मेम्ब्रेन ने किया हुआ है. इसके अलावा एंडोप्लाज्मिक रेटिकुलम, गॉल्गी बॉडी, ये सभी जो मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड ऑर्गेनेल्स हैं वो यूकैरियोट्स में प्रेजेंट होते हैं. सो आई थिंक ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दिस एक्सप्लेनेशन यू ऑल नो विच ऑफ द ऑर्गेनिजम्स आर मोर एडवांस्ड. एवोल्यूशन में कौन बाद में आए, कौन ज्यादा एडवांस्ड है? यूकैरियोट्स आर मोर एडवांस्ड. प्रोकैरियोट्स एवोल्यूशन के प्रोसेस में पहले डेवलप हुए और फिर फर्दर एवोल्यूशन में यूकैरियोट्स डेवलप हुए. तो अब आप देखिए कितना फर्क है इनमें. प्रोकैरियोट्स आर प्रिमिटिव, यूकैरियोट्स आर एडवांस्ड. स्टिल कैरोलस लिनियस डिड नॉट डिफरेंशिएट बिटवीन द प्रोकैरियोटिक एंड यूकैरियोटिक ऑर्गेनिजम्स एंड ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ देयर एक्सटर्नल मॉर्फोलॉजी ही ग्रुप्ड देम टुगेदर. व्हाट अ बिग फ्लॉ. पर ये फ्लॉ बाद में पता चला जब फर्दर इन्वेस्टिगेशन हुई. He also grouped unicellular and multicellular organisms together. Unicellular organism जो एक ही सेल का बना हुआ है. Multicellular जिसकी बॉडी में एक से ज्यादा सेल पाए जाते हैं. ये organisms को भी उसने एक ही ग्रुप में डाल दिया. इन सभी के examples हम आगे डिस्कस करेंगे. I'm just giving you an overview of the criticism right now. Then he also grouped photosynthetic and non-photosynthetic organisms together. See, plants में उसने कहा green plants भी प्लांट्स हैं और फंजाई भी प्लांट है. हमें पता है कि फंजाई में तो क्लोरोफिल नहीं होता है, ये तो फोटोसिंथेटिक नहीं है, नॉन फोटोसिंथेटिक है, लेकिन दोनों को इसने उठाकर प्लांट्स में डाल दिया. सो दिस इज द दीज फीचर्स वर नॉट कंसिडर्ड इन द टू किंगडम क्लासिफिकेशन. सो दिस वेंट अगेंस्ट लिनियस, ऑल्दो ही वॉज अ ग्रेट साइंटिस्ट, अ ग्रेट बायोलॉजिस्ट, बट एवरी पर्सन डज सम फ्लॉज. सो ही ऑल्सो डिड these flaws, and of course by doing flaws When we identify our flaws, then only we improve. So that is how science improved, that he gave direction to the other scientists to work upon his work, to think about upon his work and improve further. So now we can see the criticism or demerits of two kingdom classification. The two kingdom classification system did not indicate any evolutionary relationship between plants and animals. उसने कोई evolution पे ध्यान नहीं दिया, ये नहीं सोचा कौन से organisms, कौन से species की common ancestry है जो evolution में closely related है, उनको एक single group में डालना चाहिए, लेकिन उसने evolutionary distinct organisms को भी common group में डाला, ये उसकी बहुत बड़ी गलती थी. It grouped together the prokaryotes like bacteria, blue-green algae with other eukaryotes. अभी मैंने आपको बताया bacteria, blue-green algae को ही green plants के साथ उन्होंने plants, kingdom plants में डाल दिया, kingdom planty में डाल दिया. तो ये बहुत बड़ी गलती थी कि आप prokaryotes को eukaryotes के साथ डाल रहे हो, जबकि evolution में prokaryotes तो बहुत ही primitive organisms थे, पहले develop हुए थे और eukaryotes बाद में develop हुए थे, तो इनकी जो lineage है वो काफी distinct है. Okay, he also grouped unicellular and multicellular organisms together. I just told you, कैसे उन्होंने एक साथ डाल दिए ये, ठीक है? तो unicellular and multicellular organisms को एक साथ नहीं डालना चाहिए था. Like Chlamydomonas, it's a unicellular green alga, and Spirogyra, it's a multicellular one. So he grouped all these organisms together. Now this system did not distinguish the heterotrophic fungi and autotrophic green plants. अभी explain किया मैंने आपको कि fungus एक हेटरोट्रॉफ है, उसमें क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट नहीं होता है, फोटोसिंथेसिस नहीं कर सकती है, और ऑटोट्रॉफिक ग्रीन प्लांट्स में क्लोरोफिल कंटेंट प्रेजेंट है, वो अपना खाना खुद बना सकते हैं, फोटोसिंथेसिस कर सकते हैं. इन दोनों को बिल्कुल अलग ग्रुप्स में डालना चाहिए, लेकिन लिनियस ने दोनों को किंगडम प्लांटी में डाल के बहुत गलत किया. ओके, देन ड्यूअल ऑर्गेनिजम्स लाइक यूग्लिना एंड लाइकेन डिड नॉट फॉल इनटू एनी किंगडम. I think these organisms, these groups were not discovered then. Euglena, it's a unicellular organism. It's a eukaryote. It's a very distinct organism. बहुत ही different organism है ये, क्योंकि इसमें plant और animal दोनों के features हैं. दोनों जैसा behavior show करता है ये. कैसे? जब sunlight की availability होती है, तो उस time पर Euglena sunlight की presence में photosynthesis करता है, क्योंकि इसके अंदर chlorophyll content present है. लेकिन सनलाइट की एब्सेंस में यूग्लिना हेटरोट्रॉफिक मोड ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन फॉलो करते हुए फोटोसिंथेसिस नहीं कर पाता, हेटरोट्रॉफ बन जाता है. तो ये ड्यूअल ऑर्गेनिज्म कहलाता है, बिकॉज इट इज फोटोसिंथेटिक एज वेल एज हेटरोट्रॉफिक, इट इज ऑटोट्रॉफिक एज वेल एज हेटरोट्रॉफिक. सो यूग्लिना को किसी भी ग्रुप में नहीं डाला गया, ना प्लांट कंसिडर किया गया ना एनिमल, तो ही जस्ट इग्नोर्ड यूग्लिना. लाइकिन इट इज अगेन अ वेरी डिस्टिंक्ट ग्रुप, इट इज अ एसोसिएशन बिटवीन the algae and fungi. इसको भी classification में include नहीं किया गया, which was a great drawback in the two kingdom classification system given by Carolus Linnaeus. Okay, he also did not mention some acellular organisms like viruses and viroids. आज हमें पता है viruses कितने important हैं. You all must be knowing the importance of viruses because of the lockdown. It is because of coronavirus. तो क्या हम वायरस की एग्जिस्टेंस को इग्नोर कर सकते हैं? बिल्कुल नहीं कर सकते. तो वायरस और वायरॉइड को अगर आपने किसी ग्रुप में नहीं डाला है, तो ये बहुत बड़ा फ्लॉ है, विच वी कैन अंडरस्टैंड टुडे. सो ऑल दीज ड्रॉबैक्स और द डीमेरिट्स वर कवर्ड ओवर, दे वर थॉट अपॉन, एंड फाइनली अ मोर एडवांस्ड सिस्टम ऑफ क्लासिफिकेशन केम इन टू एग्जिस्टेंस, विच वॉज गिवन बाय द साइंटिस्ट रॉबर्ट हारिंग Whittaker, R.H. Whittaker. He gave the five kingdom classification. So after this two kingdom classification, we move on to five kingdom classification. This is more advanced. Of course, this is the classification we are following now. So in this classification system, we can see there are five kingdoms. Kingdom Monera, Kingdom Protista, Kingdom Fungi, Kingdom Animalia, and Kingdom Fungi, Kingdom Plantae, and Kingdom Animalia. So the sequence goes like this: Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia. So all these kingdoms, all these five kingdoms were given by R.H. Whittaker. So how this five kingdom classification is more justified? This is more justified because it was based on these five features. These five aspects were considered to give five kingdom classification. The first feature is cell structure. Cell structure means whether the organism is a prokaryote or eukaryote. Prokaryotes and eukaryotes, these are the two types of cell structure. First aspect which five kingdom classification was based on is cell structure. So the flaw which was committed by Linnaeus was covered up by Whittaker. So first basis cell structure means he considered